I'm Rob Schuster. That intro was something I've been working on for a little while. That's a cajon that I built several years ago. I am playing it. And of course, when I was recording that, my dog Snickers had to come investigate what the heck was going on.
I love to build unique stuff. Often my stuff is built with a CNC. Some of you know me because of YouTube CNC how-to tutorials, or woodworking projects, or drum building, or even building another CNC for building drums. One of the phrases my wife just hates to hear is, "I wonder if I could make..." She knows that moment I'm about to go OCD down some rabbit hole trying to figure out how to do something that is probably a complete waste of time. Usually no one ever hears about these projects because they were a complete waste of time. But sometimes they work out for great projects, like my CNC machines. They both were probably crazy ideas at one point, but they worked out. My last "I wonder if I could make" moment was when I thought, can I make a drum with a puzzle pattern wrapping around the drum? I thought a long time about this. I did many test cut pieces on the CNC just to get the joint right. And even then, I still wasn't sure if I could make this work. So here are some of the test pieces I was doing. I cut these many, many times, different shapes and patterns. I finally came up with a gap that was about right. Again, the goal was to press it together so it's firm but not impossible to press together. My goal was to have my little trigger clamps to squeeze it together so it wouldn't be breaking anything, but also be not so loose, there'd be a gap in there. A gap would be just not professional, I thought. So I did this many times, different shapes, trial and error. All I can say is it was a lot of testing back and forth. I finally got to the point where I did shapes this way. This is both the light one is always has the outie on the inside and the dark one has the innie. So it alternated. And that's the final shape I came up with. These two joints here would always be a flat 90 degree angle. And these would always be the angle to make a shape around a drum. Again, lots of test cuts, so many test cuts here. We did more test cuts. I learned a few things after I built the drum on how you would assume be the same way with the grain as against the grain, but it does deviate a little bit and it got much tighter in situations than I expected. And we'll get to that later. So that's some testing there. And let's actually go and look at the final cutouts I did. We'll see videos of these in a second. To not waste a lot of wood, I tried to nest these as close together as I could. So, and this actual line you'll see cut out. Those are actually the shapes that I ended up with, where I cut them in different pieces. Lots of design went into this. A lot of thought process went into this. And we'll see the exact same thing now for the other one. So that has the outie on the side there. This one will have the innie on the side here. Same basic idea, nesting together so I don't waste as much wood. And now after all my babbling, it's time to actually watch the CNC start cutting some wood. I am running three separate tool paths to cut out these parts. The first tool path is running right now. That cuts the outside edge or the smooth edge of the puzzle piece. Then the second tool path will cut out the innie or outie part of the puzzle piece. This one is the dark color, so it will be the innie. And the third tool path will separate the pieces into individual pieces. On a side note, what I'm using here is red oak, but it's been roasted or torrefied, some people like to say. Normally when they harvest wood and then set it at the retail store, they run it through a kiln process to dry it out. Wet wood, it's bad for woodworking projects. It warps, curls, lots of things that are undesirable. So they normally kiln it, and that's great. This process, they run it through the kiln longer and hotter, and it turns it dark. I've also worked with roasted maple. It turns it more of a reddy rust color. Again, very good. I've liked it for some projects. One of the side benefits of this, it's got a wonderful smell when you cut it. It smells like you're smoking meats in a smoker or something. Really cool. And here's a quick shot of the software that runs the CNC machine. The dot going back and forth is actually where the router bit is cutting the wood. pretty much the same process now with the birch versus what we did with the dark roasted oak. The first step was to do the flat edges. We've already run those tool paths. Second tool path is to cut out the outy part of the puzzle. And then the third and final step is to split those into individual pieces. And now to actually start gluing things up. These are the first two pieces. These two actually went together relatively smooth, so that's why I kind of picked those out so I could do it by hand without too much work, effort. Some of them were a little tighter, but still very manageable. This was the easiest part of the process. I thought it was going to be real smooth at this point. Push it together with a little bit of effort, and then clamp it, just get that last little get it perfect. Needless to say, I was feeling pretty confident at this point. And here are some shots of multiple of these glued up, and another shot, then a second of a whole stack of them. I needed 16 to wrap around the drum. I made a couple extras, so I think I've got 18 there. And now to answer the question that everyone has been asking, how on earth did I cut that puzzle pattern at an angle like that? We're back to the CNC design software to see how I did that. The first step was to import a wedge shape into my CAD program. 11 1/4 degrees, I'll explain that math in a little bit. And that's the starting point for everything. With the CNC machine, I cut out a wedge. And it's a jig that holds down the pieces so I can cut the puzzle shape on the side at the right angle. And back to the CAD program. As you can see on the left, there's an image that follows the contours of the puzzle piece. That's a jig that will go on the jig, if that makes any sense. And on the right-hand side, you can see what I'm trying to match up to. And here is a quick shot of the jig on a jig. And now we have another view of the jig, this time with the puzzle piece clamped in place, ready to CNC. The jig that follows the contour of the puzzle piece is really important. With that, I can cut the puzzle piece, remove that puzzle, and then put another one in the exact same position so it's very repeatable, have the exact same shape time and time again. And now back to some live video at the CNC machine. Here I'm actually mounting a piece into the jig. As you can see, it's at an 11 1/4 degree angle, and I'm clamping it in. It fits very well in that clamp, so I know every time it will repeat, as I said before, very repeatable. That's so important. If you don't have a consistent piece, it will never match up in the end. So it takes a minute or two to clamp it in. And now we'll run the CNC, and I'll let it go regular speed for the first pass, and then after that I'll speed it up because it looks the same time and time again. Normally when cutting stuff like this, I use my dust boot and use the dust collection, but in this case, it doesn't do great video, so I'll just put up with a mess today. If you watch closely, you'll notice the bit will actually go up and down as it follows that 11 1/4 degree wedge. It's following that shape, basically. That was an option in the 3D CAD software. You can project a toolpath on top of a 3D shape, so it works really well and does not cut into the wedge template that I have. It follows that contour very nicely. Now we remove the clamps, and there we have a puzzle piece with 11 1/4 degree angle. My camera did not do a good job recording the video for cutting the other side of the puzzle piece, but no big deal. It's almost exactly the same as the other side. The big difference is the jig I use, the jig on the jig, actually. This one has the puzzle piece that it'll plug into, hold it in place, and again, once you have it set up right, you can repeat the cut time and time again and get perfect, repeatable results. I've mentioned multiple times through the video using 11 1/4 degree angle to make the drum come out right. Here's a calculator I use online. Just Google Stave drum calculator, you'll find it real easy. I'm using a drum that has 16 flat edges or staves, even though I'm not sure a puzzle piece really counts as a stave, but the number still works, so I'm calling it that. When you have 360 degrees divided by 16, you get 22 and a half degrees, and cut that in half, because there's two pieces together to make that angle, it's 11 and a quarter. So that's why I keep mentioning 11 and a quarter degrees for the drum. And here are a few quick shots of the staves before final assembly. And it's finally time to start gluing things together. My original thought was to get two pieces to glue together at a point, then two more, and so on. So I'd have 8 groups to glue up after that instead of 16, and then glue up those two to get 4 combined. In the end, that kind of worked, but not always. Here's another attempt. I'm adding one more to a chain of them already. The problem with these, it was much tighter than I expected. And there's multiple reasons it could be. For some reason, going with the grain versus against the grain made the joint a little tighter. I got a couple theories. It could be a little more deflection on the bit when I was cutting those. I did wait a while between those, so the wood could have absorbed a little bit of moisture and swelled a little bit, which we know wood is not constant. Things like that. But in the end, I had to tap it quite a bit with a mallet to get them together. And you'll see on this one, eventually when I tap it, there'll be a break in there. The red oak is naturally a little more brittle than other woods, with the seam especially. And once you torrify it, it's even worse yet. So in a second here, we tap it, and it's going to come out, and there it is. No big deal. I keep finishing this and get it the seam how I want it. Then I'll glue up that piece that came off. And a few more taps to get that joint just perfect. And now off camera, I'm gluing it up, and we'll clamp it up, and that joint will be basically impossible to find after it's been glued up and finished. So at this point, we have the completed raw shell. It is ready to start finishing and smoothing, skimming to get everything perfectly round inside and out. And now the CNC is rounding or skimming the outside of the drum. It'll move to the right about 4/100ths or 40/1000ths of an inch each rotation. And I try not to take more than 1/8 of an inch off each pass. Any more than that, it pushes the machine harder than I want to, and you can get bad results. I'm going to get down to 13.875 inches, which confuses some people because it's a 14-inch drum. The drum head is 14 inches, so if I go to 14-inch drum, the head won't actually fit around the drum. So that's why it's a little bit less. It's time to talk some drum theory or terminology. When I say the word bearing edge, it might not make sense to everyone except for drummers out there. This is kind of the standards what people use out there in drum making. This is the outside edge of the drum, the inside of the edge of the drum, same thing here. And there's always a rounded edge there. Not always, I shouldn't say always, but most often there's a rounded edge. This is a 1/4-inch radius on this example, an 1/8-inch radius on this one, and then a 45-degree cutaway back to the middle of the drum. 45, again, is normal, but not always. So that's the two basic edges. The drum head actually would conform to that to a point. Then over here would be the tension rods pulling down away and the center of the drum here. So that's the two standard ways of doing that. And the way to do that is to get a 1/4-inch radius bit with a ball bearing following edge and go around the drum and put that edge on the drum. Common way of doing it. And I've done that way in the past, but I've switched to a new version that I'm developed myself that I'm kind of proud of. So I'm doing what I call a compound radius. So it very gradually starts arcing in or curving in till it gets to a very tight radius here, basically an 1/8 inch in the very end. I'm not claiming this is better or worse because I have no proof of that, and I'm not going to build a bunch of drums that are identical with slightly different things. I just have my own intuition. I think it's cool. And I would like to think it might be a little better, but I have no proof of that, so I'm not making that claim to anyone. But there is a little more contact area with the drum head through here, and it still has that same sharp drop-off that's pretty standard. So, again, I think it's cool, but I have no proof that's any better or worse than any other setting. And here the CNC machine is cutting that compound radius I just described. You can see it going back and forth and dropping sharper at the end to get that shape. It takes about 45 minutes to do each side, so an hour and a half through the top and bottom combined. It's kind of cool to watch that, and I'll show a few different angles here. We can see it going up and down. You can't see the thread rod on this shot, but in this shot you can see how that thread rod reverses direction to move the machine. I always think it's almost magical how the left and right and up and down and rotary all work together to make this work out in the end. Now it's time to skim the inside of the drum. And to do that, we have to get the drum around what we would call the gantry, even though this gantry doesn't move. But there are 8 bolts holding this in place. I'll take 7 out and leave 1 attached. Then I will lift the gantry to the side while I put the drum around it, and then I'll put those 8 bolts right back in. This method does work, but if I was gonna rebuild this machine or do it again from scratch, I would probably do it a little differently than this, but like I say, it works in the end. Now that the drum is wrapped around the gantry, I will put on my spinner assembly. It's hard to describe this thing, but it has rollers, so the drum will spin on it, and it has guides on each side, so the drum will hold in the same place as it spins. Once those guides are in place, I will use nuts to hold them in place so they won't move around and the drum won't rock back and forth. I use a belt that goes around the drum and to a timing pulley that will turn the drum as we skim the inside of the drum. When I was first building this machine, I had a hard time finding timing pulleys that would work. And finally, somebody suggested, why don't you cut your own? You have a CNC. I mentioned before, when I cut the outside of the drum, I'll take up to 1/8 of an inch off per pass. Since this is only held in place by a timing belt, and it's only held on the sides, it's not locked into place, I take much less per pass. So in turn, it takes longer to skim the inside of the drum than the outside of the drum. For this drum, I'm doing something different for me. I'm going to use this Z-Poxy finishing resin epoxy. And actually, it won't be the finishing coat. I'm just using this to fill grain, and so it'll absorb into the drum and hopefully make the wood a little bit stronger. I'll do this inside and outside, and on the outside, I will sand it down and do a second coat for more grain filling. This is new to me, because often when I do a drum, I do a 3D carving in it, and grain filling is not an option because I don't want to fill in the 3D carving. I want those edges to be as sharp and clean as possible, so that would defeat the purpose. So even though a lot of people do grain filling, this is actually a new step for me. I've seen this technique used multiple times in the past on the YouTube page for Highline Guitars. He does a really good job on showing and explaining finishing techniques. When I first built my CNC machine, I was going to use this assembly to hold the drum in place while it was being CNC'd. It didn't work out how I expected, and when you got it tight enough to hold the drum in place, it actually would expand out a little bit and make the drum not truly round, so it was a failure for that. But then I realized, for finishing the drum and spinning it easily when there's no pressure on it, it worked great, so it's now part of my finishing process. Now for my special secret recipe for finishing the drum. This clear coat is awesome stuff. Been using it for years and I won't give out my secret. Actually, it's just General Finishes Armor Seal I wipe on. Works great. One of the problems I have with good quality finishes is that you open the can, you take out an ounce, you close back up the can again. You open it up, take another ounce out. And if you're putting 4 or 5 layers on, that's 4 times there, and over 6 months or even a few months, that can has been exposed to a lot of oxygen, and that's bad for the finish. So I went to Amazon and found these resealable bags for finishes, and it works great. The finish is good to the last drop now. This is actually the second time I shot this video of me putting down the first layer of finish. However I want to say that. The first time my camera angle is off so far, you could not see me putting the finish down. This time it's still not a great shot, but at least you can see what I'm doing here. So I'm not doing it a third time just to put one layer of finish down. I eventually put down 5 layers of finish, sanding between, and it's got a pretty good finish now. Now for the final beauty shot. To say I'm happy with how this came out would be an understatement. When I first thought of this, it was more of a mule or a test drum just to see it was possible. I really did not think it would come out to be something that would be showable to the public. And in the end, this thing is really nice. I've had many compliments on it already, and I haven't even shared it that many places. If you're interested in this drum or others, contact me through the Facebook group Sidewinder Drums or send me a message through YouTube.